Balance and flow, a time to let go. Stretch, bend, build strength. See yourself in a new way. Explore your shapes. Find your shape.
Hello everyone, my name is Macara Hitchcock. I am 21 years old. I am a 4'11", tiny petite, powerful ball of a woman who enjoys the aerial arts. The aerial arts are art forms such as wira, aerial silk or hammock, or also the very popular world-renowned pole arts in general. In my spare time, I like to drink tea. I love fried rice, also paired with sushi, also paired with popcorn, and also paired with my two cats, who are my kids on my living terror in hell. Oh, Jesus, okay. Before I started aerial, I was ruining my life. I was obsessed with the wrong people, the wrong things, the wrong activities. I was worried about what everyone thought and not about what I thought about myself. I was so unhealthy. I was like 30 pounds bigger. I was just not active. I sat down all day just living in my head, and that will drive you insane. Trust me. Like, the second I actually started picking up a physical activity between the aerial arts, I just noticed how more mindful I was of what I was eating, what I was participating in, the music I was listening to, who I was hanging around. I was really just becoming more conscious of it as an individual, and even noticing how my body responds. Like, yes, I'm sore today, but then tomorrow, oh, my skin looks a little tighter here. Oh, my stomach hurts, but I know it's a really defined line here. And notice how I was getting healthier in my body as well, losing a whole bunch of weight, but also that confidence that comes with I'm doing the right thing. My research is kind of in line with one of my goals. How I stated it, I feel like there's a lot you can do with aerial arts that are being overlooked or just not utilized appropriately. So my big part of my research is looking into one of those many ways, which is for a trauma and stress intervention. There's been research that's been previously done. There's a very popular book right now, I think it's called The Body Keeps the Score, and it pretty much talks about how intentional movement can help resolve trauma over time. And he looks at this through the practice of yoga. Because with yoga, you know, there's a lot of mindfulness, there's a lot of benefits that come from, you know, a full body flow, figuring out that strength, that flexibility. It is an all-body workout that is accessible to everyone. I am a huge yoga enthusiast. I hope to get certified in it myself because there's just some things that are undeniable about yoga and its benefits that truly changes lives. And aerial has changed my life. Yoga wasn't what did it for me. This is what did it for me. And if millions of people can be affected by the benefits of yoga, millions of people can be affected by the benefits of aerial arts. It can change your life. It can cause you to be super healthy. It can cause you to have all these great resolutions in your relationships. Whatever yoga can do for you, aerial can do for you is the moral of the story. So the stress benefits I'm looking at, I'm also looking at how it mentally benefits you. Same thing in yoga, there's a lot of mindfulness, there's a lot of meditational aspects. And you can do that with pole, you can do that with aerial, you can do that with hammock. It's a lot of, you know, breath work. Like, are you paying attention to your body? Are you breathing when you need to breathe? Are you taking a break when you need to take a break? It is the same exact thing here. And once you learn to have that control over something like aerial, you're gonna start seeing that same control in the rest of your life. It all goes in flow with each other. Benefits of movement. So it is just giving your body the chance to move. You ever feel like you're just sitting down too long and you need to get up and do something? Well, aerial arts is it. Come visit me. That was just a little promo for my ad as a teacher. Okay, anyways, the benefits of movement. It's just allowing your body that chance to move. Like, literally as simple as I put it. You know, when you're sitting over time, you start to get stiff, you start to get tired, you start to just, you know, allow your mind to drift. And the biggest benefit, I think, of movement is to allow yourself a mental break, which is why I feel like it's been so, you know, beneficial with yoga or working out. Or you ever hear people say, oh, I had a long day, I need to go to the gym. Why? Because they need to get up and move. Second thing is it allows your body to have a sense of a strengthening release. It's like the way I like to put it. I was certified with a woman through my aerial teacher training who specialized in a trauma-informed aerial yoga, and it focuses on this group called the psoas muscle system. So it lies in between your hips. It is where your sit bones are located. It connects the bottom half of your body to the top part within your core. It is literally the central hub for, am I a functioning human being? Super important. And aerial specifically focuses on that. Each form of aerial arts has this special move that's called an invert. And when you invert, that's when you're literally bringing your body upside down. And when you're bringing your body upside down, you're doing a lot of crazy things at once. One of the biggest thing is kind of allowing this thing called a facial release. I think this is very important because we have, you know, this detoxifying lymph that sits over time. If you're not moving a lot, you can get that fascia buildup, which is kind of like this residue. I had to watch a video of it. So think of a piece of raw chicken, and that slimy stuff around the chicken is the same slimy stuff that goes around your muscles. And that's what's causing you to be able to, you know, move fluidly and whatnot. And when you invert, when you're going upside down, you're allowing it to kind of, again, give your body a whole spinal decompression, number one. So if you struggle with, you know, knee lower back issues, sciatica, scoliosis, you're gonna benefit from that with your invert. But number two, you're kind of allowing for that detoxifying release. And you know, I look at things one step ahead. I feel like you get detoxifying release on your physical, but your mental and your spiritual. Just, you know, take out the trash, why don't you? Flip the trash can over, do an invert. And there's benefits, like I stated, it has been proven to, you know, help provide mental clarity and focus, that physical benefit with the spinal decompression, allowing, you know, the muscle systems to have a chance to, you know, kind of detoxify as well. Then final thing with movement is strength. All of these moves, you're going to increase your flexibility, you're going to increase your strength, and most importantly, in my opinion, is you're going to increase your balance. And once you have your balance together, you'll know how to find your flow. My biggest boundary regarding aerial arts is who can do it. I want to believe everyone can do this because I want everyone to do this. I want big people to do this. I want people with disabilities to do this. I want people who have dealt with sexual trauma to do this. I want for men to do this. I want for white people to do it, black people to do it, Asian people to do it, Indian people to do it. The whole I had a dream speech, I want them to apply to this. And the barrier is convincing yourself as a teacher, but also making sure you can convince your student, like, or whoever you want to do this. Like, how do you market yourself so you're like, I can do this? Another boundary is, again, that image that's associated with it. Now, while someone may have, you know, some insecurities within themselves as why to they can't, there's a lot of insecurities associated with if they did, how would they look? So it's like you have two big barriers. The first one is, how am I gonna view myself? How are others gonna view me? And if you're not okay with either of those, you're gonna be like, I shouldn't do it. And that's the biggest boundary. That's the biggest boundary. How am I going to look? How are others going to view me? And then I feel like the final one is, what am I doing with it? Are you using it in an empowering way? Are you using it in a positive way? Are you using it in a way to uplift and help and encourage others? Or are you degrading yourself and others around you with how you use it? And man, there's just so much with that, which is why I think it's gotten such a bad reputation because of, you know, how these aerial arts have been misused, you know. And it's so much more than that. I feel like judging aerial arts is the same way you judge a person. Yes, there can be two sides, but what do you see more at the end of the day, the good or the bad? And I want to be able to add a good reputation to aerial arts, which in itself is a boundary because it's difficult. Hypersexualization. Aerial arts is hypersexualized because even though this may not be popular in all strands of life, it is popular in the field of sex work. There's a lot of negative connotations that's associated with sex work because of society's views, and it is replicated on the sport in general, especially those who choose to partake in it. Hypersexualization. to reiterate, is just over-sexualize something that does not need to be sexualized. Even though it has been used in a term where it's being sexualized, it's also a term where it's being used in growth. Now, we're gonna get a little bit into trauma. I don't know the exact statistics, my apologies. But minorities suffer from a lot of trauma. A little bit more trauma than white people do. There's a lot of economic factors that play into this. You have, you know, your income, you have your education, what was your family dynamic, how were your relationships with others, how were relationships with your community. And when you come from a minority background, you don't have a lot of security in those different things. Whereas a white person may have, you know, good finances, be in a good school system, be connected with the social community, have a healthy and active lifestyle, and are actively and healthily eating good foods and encouraging things that are good for them. So, minorities, we have African American women, we have African Americans in general, we have the Latino Hispanic background, and we have Asians, or, you know, the dominant term, people of color, even if it's someone who might be an immigrant, I'll count them in a minority, just people who are underrepresented in general and, you know, don't have the same benefits that the dominant trait does, which is white people in America. That being said, let's say there's another black girl who decides to get involved in pole because of the benefits that she has found within herself, within her others, and just in her life the same way that I have. But let's say, you know, she specializes in pole and she's wearing a sports bra and underwear to grip the pole since she needs skin to grip. How is she being viewed by society? And then we have a white girl who's in the same exact outfit, posts a picture, and she's being praised, you know, for her new and exciting venture and how beautiful she looks and how strong she looks. The black girl is gonna get dogged out. The black girl is gonna get called a hoe, a thot, whatever you want. She's gonna have the worst assumptions made about her and just pinned into being this horrible type of person. While the white girl's like, oh, you're so cute. Okay, cool. And I just feel like it goes with society's, you know, wanting to degrade black women in general. Like, I don't know why we're at the bottom of the totem pole. I really do not. I think we're great, but maybe I'm biased. But I just think we're, like, considering that we get shitted on so bad, like, get talked about, get told this, that, whatever, 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 to make us feel like, you know, we look like a dog, or we behave like this, or it's ghetto when we do that, we still find a way to conquer out on top. I don't care. Like, I don't care who's in charge, but she's really running the game at the end of the day. That's how it goes in my brain, at least. But it's just, you know, I feel like when it comes to something where you can be more vulnerable and more revealing for once, people are sexualizing it on black women. Because that same strength and journey that she had to go through of allowing herself to do this and allowing her to get where she wants to be, whereas in a white woman, they're giving her accolades and praise. And like I stated, on a black woman, they're degrading her for doing something that she wanted to do and conquering it, period. My future goals with this research is, again, to break the stigma, explore all the areas that this can really take someone, and, you know, help people find their flow. What I hope to see for myself, I like teaching. This is the first time I've struggled with this at, like, beginning, because it's like I feel like I can talk a lot about something, but actually being able to educate someone and get it the way that I understood it, or even in a similar way where it's connecting, is difficult. But I noticed me getting better. I notice I have students who come back, I have familiar faces, and I have relationships that are being built. And, you know, I want to cultivate that in the future, and I want to influence people with this. I really do. And it's a difficulty because it's like back to before, how can I use this to educate and inform and assist, as opposed to falling to the different stigmas and stereotypes that are associated with this sport? You're literally trying to figure out how to be society's perfect image. I don't know. It's confusing. But again, at the very least, I want to continue to teach. I want to help. And maybe one day open a studio. I'm not opposed to the idea of a studio. I think having a safe space, especially for minorities to go, would be great. Like, if you were to put a studio that focuses on aerial arts in an urban area, the black people who are going to get involved, you know, maybe seeing their representation more so among men, but people of color using it as well. And how is it helping them resolve their trauma? Like, I don't want to see anyone down bad, but if I know if I can help someone work through it, I will. I may not be the best communicator, I may not be the best listener, but I can show you how to move your body to shake off some of that, you know, stress or whatever. So, final goals I see for it, practicing what I preach. There's a lot of benefits that come from this, and I want to make sure that I'm, you know, just being a good role model. I want to make sure that, you know, I'm talking my talk, I'm walking my walk, so people can be like, okay, this is what she did, this is how she did it, and these were her results. Because when we see someone doing good, we want to figure out how they did it, what they did to do it, and we just want to be as successful as them, if not better. Because, you know, humans in general, we want to make sure we're in a good space, like whether it be financially, spiritually, mentally, whatever. So again, being a good role model, making sure I can actually assist my students the way that I have been trying to assist myself. Okay, goodbye. Have a blessed day. Greetings. No longer greetings. Hello. Goodbye. Please leave a message after the tone. Goodbye.